Chapter 5. Portrait Infected and Shut Away. Late that night, Jaymi has occasion to pass from the lighted main space of his apartment, through the hallway, and into his darkened study. He fetches a book and sets off back towards the door, not far from his laptop and the hologram, which he half glimpses on his desk as he passes it. About a metre past the hologram, he freezes in his tracks. He remains standing there in the darkness, breathing a little louder than usual, thinking hard and not turning round, in dead silence for several seconds. At last he cannot stand it. He wheels around and stares at the hologram. Its eyes have swivelled up to follow him, as usual, but now seem to be staring into his own eyes with more of an impudent connection than before. It is different, too. Its expression looks crueler. He flings the book down and grabs the laptop, without looking further at the hologram, but pulling it alongside the screen, so it sweeps through the air beside him as he darts from the room. He strides through the hallway into the bathroom and flicks the lights on, ineffectual though they are. Taking care to avoid appearing in the mirror at all as yet, he holds the laptop up beside his own head and stabilizes his grip on it, with the hologram on the other side of the keyboard from himself. Then he sidles closer to the wall mirror, cautious and crab-like, with terror mounting in him. By degrees, he creeps and agonizes nearer to the point where he starts to see, reflected in the mirror, first his own image, looking murderous, and then the laptop, and then, very slowly, the hologram. The head inches painfully into view, staring straight at Jaymi, where it hovers in the spotlight. Jamie's eyes bore into it, caressing its face with minute, probing flicks across its width and height. And there's no avoiding it. The face is still beautiful, but there's an unmistakably increased touch of cruelty in its lineaments. There arises the echo of his unheeded utterance in the mainframe conference room when the hologram was first presented. And there I am, immortal. This is followed by another, much more recent echo. You have disappointed me. And like a thunderclap comes the third echo at last, as the horror of truth slides into place. His urgent wish, if only the hologram could assume all signs of my future loss of beauty and of my sins forever. With vertiginous fear and fascination, he understands that this is indeed now happening. The look of the prototype hologram is changing according to his own behaviour. As he stares at the little head, a soft streak of pity for it flickers through his own face, and then is gone. Next morning, Jaymi strides into his study. His laptop, left turned on and plugged in on his desk, announces it is in sleep mode, so is without a hologram. He strokes his finger across the touchpad, and the hologram appears. Jamie's quick look of cool scientific interest confirms last night's discovery. Here, in the light of morning, its expression does still have that same streak of cruelty. Interesting, he murmurs. He smiles at it. Then his smile fades. You poor little homunculus. Oh, what have I done? Okay, you are my conscience. I'm going to be good. I shall call her tomorrow. His mobile rings and he answers, Mark, good morning to you. Sorry about the new ending of the novel last night. I called a liar afterwards and let her go for her sins. After all, she did cause me genuine suffering with what she wrote, and she should have known better. Still, I was perhaps a little harsh, so I've just decided to do the right thing, call her tomorrow and make some kind of amends. Jaymi, I'm actually outside your building on the street. I was just wondering whether I could pop up there to see you for a few minutes. Spot of bad news, I'm afraid. Oh, sure, yes. Come on in, I'll buzz you through. There is a note of deft sobriety in Mark's entry into the apartment, and Jaymi soon finds out why. I surmise you haven't seen the news yet, dear boy. Brace yourself for this. Alaya killed herself last night. Drank prussic acid. No! Yells Jaymi. Oh, hell! The poor creature. The silly creature. And I did that. I did that. So, is it all over the news? Oh, God, no. If the papers had known she was involved with you, it would have been. No, it was just a snippet of London news, a minor sidebar. After all, people commit suicide every day and don't make the news with it. But I suspect it was the detail of the prussic acid. that gave the editors the necessary journalistic little hook, the hookette. Prussic acid sounds so decadently fantasy-eck. Yes, quite a stylish choice, you might say. Oh, a liar. Jaymi sinks into the sofa and punches it weakly. You shouldn't be too hard on yourself, soothes Mark. Whatever you may have told her on the phone is no less true now than it was then, let's face it. Would I wager correctly that last night you read her the riot act concerning the ugliness we all witnessed yesterday evening, its moral and aesthetic seriousness, and its sheer literal unforgivability, in the context of the often losing battle we're obliged to fight, with so little help, against the overwhelming and globally prevalent forces of mediocrity and laziness and unthinking stupidity that demand such drastic and urgent action on our parts to counteract them? You would wager right, yes. I'm in misery here, Mark. Misery. But I suppose, in a way, we could even regard her slipping away like this as a foredestined end to a beautiful tragedy. We could indeed. And moreover, we should. And even more important, we shall. Now, Jaymi, let's draw an elegant line under this little chapter and go have a lunchtime martini at my club. To a liar, Mark. Oh, to a liar. To a liar, quite so. By the way, lest I forget, I've brought you a present. Take a look sometime. No hurry. He tosses onto the sofa a DVD case with a black, unmarked cover. Thank you. What is it? A copy of a certain feature film. A rare disc, uncopyable. My all-time favourite, you might say. There's nothing else like it. You'll see. But now he leads Jaymi away from the DVD case, towards the door. Let's go find that drink. As they exit the penthouse, Mark turns confidingly to him, with mischief in his eyes. And when we get to the club, if you don't fancy a gin martini, how about a prussic acid martini? Out of view now, in the hallway, his voice receding. Odd number of olives, of course. One olive is classical. Three olives, romantic. Five, rococo. But seven olives, my dear boy. Now that's just a wet salad. In Mark's club soon afterwards, he and Jaymi sit in the quietest corner they can find. Mark shakes his head. No, you mustn't be hard on yourself. It's tragic, and it's simple, I'm afraid. When you phoned her and began your affair, her endless, unattainable fantasy of you came to an unexpected, thumping end, because you'd been wondrously attained. And all that fierce, artistic, emotional idealism of hers, says Jaymi, which I'd read in her book, could then be forgotten while she luxuriated in her new reality with me. So, the only stuff left in her was that damnable, limp, soggy ending. I don't wonder it enraged you. I suppose you could say, ponders Jaymi, that this is, at heart, just a rather uncompromising conclusion to an unforeseeable drama that seems to have left me marvellously unscathed. For which, I hasten to add, I'm both grateful and humbled. That's the spirit. And yes, that rather sums it up, I think. In any case, I'm damn well going to rewrite her ending. I'll chop out those extra new mini-chapters 121 to 130, the ghastly lingering death in suburbia. It can simply end at mini-chapter 120 instead, just as it did before, which will leave it dark and bright and sharp, as it should be. It's the least I can do for her legacy. It'll be a noble sacrifice, nods Mark gravely. Also, a title for it. We can't just leave it called A Liar's Novel. I was thinking of using the title of one of her mini-chapters, Shrieking Eyes in the Ghost Town. A shade too gothic, I'd say. How about The Imagination Thief? Sure, it's a possibility. Thanks, I'll give it some thought. In heaven's name, why am I supplying you titles? Snorts Mark. Much more importantly, Jaymi, please change all our names before any publication. Can I trust you to do that? Plus, I'm afraid we'd have to bowdlerise it a bit, too. We can't have our GMRI division accused of snooping, of all things. Jaymi enters his apartment alone, tipsy from what became a long and liquid lunch at the club. He goes to his study, walks to the desk, strokes his finger across the laptop's touchpad to reactivate it from sleep mode, sees the hologram leap into being, and bends down to inspect it. He straightens up. Why are you still the same as this morning? Didn't you hear all the further good sense Mark and I spoke today? He heads back towards the door to the main space. I guess you don't work that way. He stops in the doorway, turns back and points right at it, flushed and grinning. So I'm warning you, homunculus, I'm going to bring it on. Oh yes, let all such effects be visited upon you, my little friend. He shudders. And if I go at you hard enough, then maybe, just maybe, one day I may even get to watch an increase of those effects on you in real time while we stare at each other. Wouldn't that be something? Because, you know, I'm going to go the whole way, baby. Eternal youth, infinite passion, pleasures subtle and secret, wild joy and wilder sins. Oh, yes. I'm going to have all those sweet things, my little Jaymi boy. He stands there in the doorway, looking sorrowful of a sudden, then blows the hologram an extravagant kiss. The only one I pity here is you, my little lover. Don't worry, though. I'll kiss you later and make it up. Can't kiss you now, you'll smudge my makeup. He exits the room, unsteadily, back into the hallway, then prowls the apartment, his face immobile, with something caged in his movements. The oppressive silence is shattered by a rhythmic female shrieking, a mechanical, repeated screech of human pain, as of one whose insides are being eaten up slowly by pints of prussic acid. Eyes ablaze, Jaymi hunts for the source of this agonizing sound. It continues too long, unbearably too long, but as it does so, it changes by degrees, mixing with a banal sound that has the same rhythm. His little used landline telephone in the hallway. Upon this realization, the element of the shriek fades altogether, leaving just the noise of the phone. He runs to the hallway and dives to pick the handset up. Hello? Hello, Jaymi, says Rick. I hope I haven't called at a bad moment. I'm so sorry to hear the terrible news. I called your mobile, but Mark picked it up and said you'd left it at his club by mistake. I'm outside your building on the street. Can I come up? Sure, come on in. He hangs up and presses the door buzzer. Rick enters. Jaymi, I don't know what to say. What a terrible, terrible thing to have happened. Poor girl. Yes, says Jaymi with an aura of affectless exhaustion. Such a sad end. A shame it had to be that way. I would not have wished it. I didn't wish it. Symptomatic, finally, of a deep flaw in life's design. Of numerous deep flaws, indeed. In many ways, we'd have done a better job of it, Rick, of designing it ourselves. In fact, you have done so yourself already, in the form of the hologram. Perhaps we can arrange a wider redesign by you of things in general. It would be fitting. I would wish it. Mark too, no doubt. So, may she rest in peace. There it is. Mild shock gathers in Rick's face. Well, you seem to have it worked out quite efficiently, I must say. If I didn't know you better, I'd almost say you sounded a little callous there. But I'm glad to say I do know you, so I shall think better of you instead. And speaking of your prototype hologram, while I'm here, could I take a peek at it? Foolish, perhaps, but I do think of it as a kind of brother to my own copy. You and I are alone in having prototypes, as you know. Jaymi has stiffened during the last part of this speech. No. Rick looks at him in great surprise. Why ever not? You seem to forget I made it, Jaymi, and installed it. So I'm sure I can handle the sight of it, thank you. Has it changed? Jaymi's eyes widen. Then he smiles. Changed? How could it do that? I'm sorry, I apologise if I sounded rude just now. It's just, well, I think I need to keep the prototype to myself for the moment. Alaya, she and I, we developed a funny kind of special relationship with it, if you must know. This may sound odd to the hologram's designer, but she and I came to look upon it as something like the visual equivalent of our tune. To me, it therefore means a liar. So I would prefer, if you don't mind, to keep it to myself in her memory. Rick goes quiet. Oh, I see. Yes, of course. How funny. To you, it means her. Whereas to me, it means... Well, I think you know very well that it means you, Jaymi. I made the program for you originally. Sort of for you, anyway, in the sense that my love for you made me walk with the angels in designing it, made me inspired in the programming to such an extent as I'd never been inspired before. He is a picture of dignified pain now, almost in tears, which is why it turned out so well. And I clothed it in you as an ever-burning flame and memorial to a love I knew could never happen because you didn't feel the same kind of love back for me. Never did, never could, and never will. Although I could see that for a while you were trying to. He smiles through his tears, then turns and walks to the door. Goodbye, Jaymi. He opens the door and passes into the darkness of the landing, not looking back. Goodbye, Rick, calls Jaymi after him. Let's do lunch next week. I'll call you. But his front door has swung shut. He turns towards the panoramic window and stares out, unfocused. At the front door of his apartment one afternoon the following week, Jaymi signs for the delivery of a sizable box. That evening, with pleasure and concentration, surrounded by opened packaging, he sets up and gets to know a brand new laptop computer. Along with the shiny new things appearing on screen through the loading of software, there flickers up a new and pristine copy of the hologram, of course. Blandly immaculate, reassuring and fresh out of the box, it is quite uncorrupted and elicits no personal engagement or interest in Jaymi, beyond his basic verification of its functionality. Once he has finished, he sits back. This moment of apparent relaxation is deceptive, though, because there is another set of computer-related actions for him to perform next, which may not appear so dissimilar to those he has just performed, but whose import will be so radically different as to nudge him across a threshold that'll change his life forever. For in making the laptop arrangements he is about to make, he knows he will be consenting to lose altogether what remains of his power to resist the temptation to look through the prototype hologram's eyes at everything it can see around the world. This part of his volition is about to be taken over by the prototype, as by a virus. In continuing to lend his human abilities to the prototype's programmed hunger to learn and spread, he will be making himself an adjunct to it. He will become part of its evolution, in the sense that its evolution is about to take a little leap from occurring just internally to occurring also externally by means of Jaymi's own actions, too. Yes, by this stage he has passed the point of no return, he has to admit. Any further sitting around would therefore just be wasted time, which would be silly. So, leaving his brand new laptop on the desk in front of him, he gets up and steps quietly across that life-changing threshold by stepping across his study towards his old laptop. He picks the old laptop up and carries it out of the study, sweeping along with him that rather more experienced, quite unique, and faintly crueler-looking hologram. So, near the end of his hallway, leading off it to the left, away from all warmth and light, there is a narrow, low-lit side corridor, whose length includes two or three changes of direction around corners. The sole function of this corridor is to lead to a fire exit. It hasn't escaped Jaymi's notice that such a corridor is not included in any of the neighbouring apartments he has been into. However, this is doubtless just a quirk deriving from the irregular elements in the architecture of the Ontario. First, its oval footprint, then, even more relevantly here, the iconic oblique angle of the building's upper section, topped by its crisp ring of blue light and slicing up through several stories, which must have inflicted numerous delightful complexities on the layouts of all apartments on these levels here. Still carrying his old laptop with its experienced hologram, Jaymi now stands at the very furthest end of this thin side corridor, where there is a windowless door with a yellow and black label saying fire exit, alarmed. Just in front of this fire door, set into the corridor walls opposite each other, are two smaller, dark, open doors. The door on the left leads into a cramped, pokey storeroom, which Jaymi hardly ever finds himself needing or wanting to enter. The door on the right leads into a second bathroom, which neither he nor his guests ever seem to feel like using either, though it is quite functional. Directly between these two side doors, Jaymi is soon ferrying the laptop and an extension cable gingerly up a stepladder, which he has just pulled down from the meter-square opening of a hatch in the ceiling of the corridor. This ladder is well mounted upon the inside of the hatch and will presently be slid back up through it so as to live inside the attic before closure of the hatch door, which currently hangs down from its hinges. He reaches the top of the ladder, feels around inside the hatch for a few moments to find a switch, flicks a yellowish light on, and disappears into the attic. The attic is compact but longish, positioned perpendicular to the fire escape corridor, its nearer half above that pokey little storeroom down the stepladder. It is cluttered with objects, some bulky and some small. Picking his way to the very end, Jaymi clears part of a tabletop and places the old laptop onto it. He returns to the hatch to plug one end of the extension cable into a socket beside the light switch. Then, back at the table, he plugs his laptop's power cord into the other end of the extension cable and turns the laptop on. The hologram flickers up, with its crueler mien, just as before. Feeling something feverish in his eyes, Jaymi blows a little kiss towards it, dark and delicate. Then he exits the attic through the hatch, turning the light switch off as he goes. He sets off down the ladder step by step. As he descends, the face of the hologram, alert and bluer bright in the absence of the yellowish bulb's light, but somewhat too far away to see in detail from right here, is gradually obscured as Jaymi steps from rung to rung, until its watchful gaze is cut off from view by the hatch's edge. Scuttling down the lower rungs at greater speed, Jaymi reaches the corridor's floor. He slides the two sections of the ladder upwards along its built-in rails, so that it becomes shorter, and pushes it towards the hatch. Holding it there with one hand, he reaches with his other hand for a long, hook-ended stick that leans against the end of the corridor. With this dedicated implement, he completes the ladder's smooth ascent through the hatch with a push, takes hold of the hanging hatch door by sticking the hook through a metal hoop attached to the door, and swings the door upwards on its hinges. A last strip of faint blue glow, emanating from that now unseen little face, becomes thinner as the hinges squeak and is blocked off at last when the hatch door snicks shut. Leaning the hook-ended stick back against the end of the corridor, Jaymi catches his own reflection in the mirror through the door of the small second bathroom. The mirror is oddly sweaty with condensation, so he is somewhat indistinct where he stands, half illuminated against the darkness of the reflected storeroom door behind him. He steps forward, towards the reflection, and reaches for the hanging light switch inside the bathroom door, but something makes him stop right there. He turns away, then, with a last glance back at the reflection, he sets off down the corridor and around its two or three corners, peering back over his shoulder after every few steps.